Hey guys, Philosopher here. We've got some movie news to talk about and some convention news to talk about. So I'm excited. I'm going to do a rant, which I don't tend to do, but I just kind of wanted to get it out of my system so that I can go ahead and do it. But yeah, we're already talking about Assassin's Creed, so we might as well go ahead and continue with that. Yeah, we before I had a podcast for Assassin's Creed, the movie starring, I believe it's Bradley Cooper. I hope I have his name right.
No, it's not Bradley Cooper.
No. It's Fassbender. Michael Fassbender. I don't know why I get their names mixed up, but starring
but
Michael Fassbender.
One's British and one isn't. Well, Irish and one isn't.
Are they? Or is he?
Yeah. Fassbender's Irish.
Okay. I actually have never heard him in an interview, so that's cool. So yeah, Michael Fassbender, not... I don't know why I was thinking Bradley Cooper. But yeah, so the trailer dropped last week on the 11th for it, and my excitement continues to grow for this movie. I know not everyone is as excited. There is some Kanye West in the trailer, which, yeah, it's... I'm excited for it, but what were you saying, Alex?
It looks interesting now that I've got a chance to see a bit more of it. Mm-hmm. I'd seen snippets of it before, but I'd seen the whole thing. Mm-hmm. It looks interesting. I've heard that it spends doesn't spend that much time in the past. Like, majority of it is more in the present day than in the past. Mm. I kind of wish we got to spend more time during that period, like in this historical stuff.
Right.
Like, particularly cinematically, the only other filmmaker thing of that really spends some time in the Inquisition as actually the historical Spanish Inquisition and not a comedic Spanish Inquisition has been, like, the... Capitan Autorist films from Spain, which are based up a series of novels and star Viggo Mortensen in the main role. Kind of historical swashbuckler kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Other than that, when I think of films set in the Spanish Inquisition or cinematic works or filmed works involving the Spanish Inquisition, the only thing that comes to mind is History of the World Part 1 and the Spanish Inquisition sketch from Monty Python. And
Yep. Movie going was exactly what you're talking about. But yeah, to kind of give a brief overview of what this movie is about. So for those of you who have never played Assassin's Creed, I love it because it mixes sci-fi and it mixes history together, and it makes this beautiful action adventure game where originally you played as a character called Desmond Miles, and he had a bloodline that had a bunch of descendants that were assassins, and they were the enemies of the Templars. And historically, they went back and they assassinated a lot of big figures. So when you play these games, you play as technically Desmond Miles, and he gets into a machine that takes him back in the past, and you get to relive history through him. And essentially, you go back and you get to see all these awesome people, these actual historic figures. Like, I can't think of the ones from the first one, but in part two, you go to Italy and you get to play as Ezio, and you get to meet Da Vinci and Machiavelli and the Borgia and all these cool people. And these are actual recreations of these cities, but as they were back in those times. So you get these beautiful cities, very well done. Very great gameplay, in my opinion. Some people don't like it, but I love it. It's like there's a parkour button. You get to hop and jump over things, and you assassinate these actual people. You get to interact with these real figures in these cities. And the first one was done so well, the city was done so well, that it actually, I can't remember the museum. Ian would know if he was here, but they used that city in the museum because it was so historically accurate. And I talk about that with VR as well, but that's a digression. But yeah, so these games have been coming out for almost a year now, almost every year now for, 5 years or so now? And now they're making a movie, and the actual developer is working with it, which is kind of rare. Usually they sell the rights and just have somebody else make the movie, but they're actually involved in it. And like we said, it stars Michael Fassbender. This one takes place during the Spanish Inquisition, and it's kind of the same concept, but it's not the same storyline. They're doing a new storyline. I don't know the character's name, but you have this new person who Michael Fassbender plays, and he goes back in the past, and you can see him. You see the advertisements for Abstergo. You see their logo, which is the bad guys who are... Abstergo is basically a front for the Templars in modern day. to kind of get everyone up to speed. So you have that. You have this modern day Michael Fassbender going back in time, back to the Spanish Inquisition, and so that's where they're going with this one. And I'm really excited because it takes place in the same universe as the game, but they're not trying to recreate the actual game storyline. So they have a lot of room for improvement, and Ubisoft, the people who made the game, are involved. So really excited. The trailer looks good to me. I still want to see more, but yeah, I just wanted to give them a quick understanding as to what the game or what this movie is about.
I like the idea of the film. I like that it is being its own separate thing from the games. While certain of the protagonists in the historical period who we've had, like Enzio Auditore di Firenze, are excellent characters and really exciting. I'm also perfectly fine with seeing new portions of the world and other assassins who are not attached to Desmond Miles, because Desmond Miles himself, one of the criticisms that's been labeled laid against him, which is a fair criticism, is a fairly milquetoast character. Miles is a kind of, Desmond Miles is kind of a bland character. He gets some characterization in some of the later games, but primarily the more interesting part is the stuff that's happening in the past. And from what I've heard in terms of the ratio of film in the present day to film in the past, it sounds like this film may be running into sort of, I guess what you could call the origin story problem. We're spending so much time in the present day because we have to set up the world and the conflict between the Assassins and the Templars and that sort of thing. Over the consequence, the part of the film which could probably be the most visually interesting and the most well fleshed out and most more exciting to be in, the parts in the past, the parts exploring the conflict of the historical conflict between the Templars and the Assassins and the sort of secret history surrounding that, that will basically end up staying on the back burner compared to the modern conflict between the Assassins and the Templars. And I kind of like how the games play that out with more, where it's using the secret history of this conflict to set up as the origin story of the modern conflict. And I can't help but feel, admittedly, I'm jumping the gun here because the film is not out yet. It might be better the other way around. The other complaint I've seen leveled against the trailer is, to a certain degree, Fassbender and the female lead in the Animus seem rather joyless. And to a certain degree, Fassbender has basically been erased, so to speak, with 100% less Arnold Schwarzenegger, and put in this device and then theoretically had his mind messed with. But on the other hand, he's getting to explore another world and demonstrate these physical abilities that he didn't have before and have this freedom of running through this city and that sort of thing, and that should theoretically be the funnest thing in the world. And it doesn't feel like he thinks that. When we see is we don't have that realization of, oh wow, this is amazing, this is the coolest thing ever. And consequently, I'm assuming where the plot arc is going to go, this is my sealed envelope prediction, that Abstergo is trying to get something out of his knowledge of the past, possibly related to a piece of Eden, which is one of the MacGuffins of the Assassin's Creed series, maybe something else entirely. And they're trying to find this information in the knowledge of Michael Fassbender's character's ancestors, and Michael Fassbender's character to turn the tables on them by picking up the skills of his ancestor to fight them in the present day. Mm-hmm. And I think that would work better, or at least I would hope that would work better, if we have this moment of Fassbender's character embracing the Animus to a degree, going, hey, this is fun, this is great, and jumping into embracing being this person, and thus he's able to pick up these skills in a way that the Templar agents haven't.
Yeah, I agree. I feel the reasoning for why he's in the Animus isn't a huge mystery to anyone who's played the Assassin's Creed series. I think it is something like the Piece of Eden or some sort of information that they need in present day. But I do also think, just from the trailer and that machine that he's kind of attached to, he's not in a bed. He's in some sort of apparatus to where he can still move around. You see him doing the superhero landing pose near the end of the trailer, which makes me think that while he's in the past, he's either recreating the motions or they're training him physically to be able to do what his ancestors could do. So I think the what or the why is kind of the same as a game, which I kind of hope that's the case, but the what and the how are the real mysteries here, the actual storyline and the turmoil of how of what's going on. I'm going to predict that it's going to be about 50-50 on past and present. I think they're going to do a lot more present than they're letting on. I think it might be 75% past even and less present. It might be wishful thinking, but I think that is the case because that just sounds way more interesting. It sounds more compelling, but it also, knowing Ubisoft, and like Aaron said, there's rumors that there might be another one. They have plenty of time to actually work on doing another present tense Assassin's Creed or even another timeline. So I think I agree with the whole was murdered or executed legally. So there's something going on in his personal past before he hops into the Animus that's probably going to transfer over here. Now, whether he's on the side with... they showed the Abstergo logo, which, again, is a Templar's, but I don't know if he's actually... The girl that's explaining everything to him, if it's kind of a similar situation to Assassin's Creed 1, where they're undercover and they're actually with the Templars, but they break them out of that, or if the Abstergo exists, the Templars exist, but this is somebody completely different trying to combat the Templars. So it's going to be really interesting. I'm excited. I think that this, along with comic book movies, that I would like to see, because there's other ones too. There's the Ratchet and Clank movie, which I haven't seen. I haven't read any reviews on it. But
it's not good.
Oh man, Tyler, I can't trust your opinion. I can't trust.
I haven't seen it yet, but it's not getting the best reviews. But yeah, what I've heard is that if you play the new PS4 game, there's no need to see the movie.
I hope that's not the case. That's terrible. Does anybody have any input on that, either on YouTube in the comments or in the chat? Let me know what you guys know about the movie. But I know they're making a Warcraft movie or a World of Warcraft movie. I think
Warcraft movie. From the trailers, it looks like it's very clearly set following the plot of the first game. Orcs come through the portal to Azeroth from their world, which is running into problems, and the orcs are being forced to flee, leading to orcs and humans being in conflict, and with perhaps a side plot of some of the orcs going, hey, we actually have to coexist with these humans. We can't just conquer and slaughter as we've done before. The humans and the elves and this sort of thing. At least humans and dwarves. I don't recall seeing that many elves in the movie.
You're right.
Trailer.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's... I haven't played that much of Warcraft 3, but I played the first two Warcraft games. And this meshes fairly well with the plot of the first Warcraft.
You think you can educate me a little bit more? Because I never played a Warcraft game.
Well, first two Warcraft games, the plot's very simple. First game, orcs are coming through a portal from another world. Humans have to come in to take them down. The forces of humans with some alliances with elves and a few other things banded together to fend off the orcish hordes and drive them back from whence they came. Warcraft 2, they come back, and then ultimately the game ends with the portal being sealed forever, or that sort of thing. Except it's not really sealed forever, because then in Warcraft 3, demons show up, and now there's a third faction.
I call them aliens, yeah. To be honest with you.
Are there any characters, like memorable characters, that you can tell me?
There's Illidan, which is like the blind night elf that gets corrupted, I think, in Part 3.
Yeah. Most of the major characters come out in Part 3, mainly because... between Part 2 and Part 3, StarCraft came out, and StarCraft had did a lot more stuff with hero units, like Jim Raynor and Tassadar and Kerrigan and that sort of thing. And this led to kind of Blizzard changing their narrative progression, and thus, whereas the first two games, there are not that really any major characters or that sort of thing, the third game put a lot more focus on character arcs and having hero characters and having, like, a narrative that played out in the campaigns of each race, which kind of worked in a certain order and fed into each other, much as the campaigns in StarCraft did, as opposed to Warcraft 1 and 2, where the ending cutscenes and the campaigns were like the story mode in the fighting, like the story mode in like early fighting games, where the ending cutscene is whoever wins, not whoever is the canonical winner of the story.
Hmm. And to kind of veer back onto the point I was trying to make is, I hope video game movies are always going to be a thing. People are going to try to make video game movies as long as video games exist. It's just the way of life as it is now in the 21st century or 22nd century, whatever century we're in.
21st right now.
I'm in the 22nd century. But yeah, Sherlock Holmes in the 22nd.
All my transporters, damn it.
Yeah, exactly. All my teleporters and my moonwalking and all that stuff. But yeah, I want to see good movie games. I want to see really good movie games. And
I am waiting for the Sly Cooper movie.
Game movies.
Sly Cooper could be good in terms of the franchise I think would work. The Uncharted movie, on the one hand, the Uncharted games are practically movies anyway, but to a certain degree, that might work in the film's favor in a way that something like Max Payne didn't with other stuff. I mean, I was kind of bummed with Max Payne, because Max Payne took so many cues from Hong Kong action movies and that sort of thing anyway. And
I had never seen the movie.
It's skippable. The first two games are really good. Remedy is excellent at putting together game narratives for their games.
Mm-hmm.
And the first two Max Payne games are perfect examples of this. Mm. They didn't work on Max Payne 3. And it kind of shows. But the first two games are very well structured, a very interesting and cohesive narrative, and the first Max Payne film, it tries to do some of the stuff with the narrative. It borrows some concepts, but it doesn't quite, they don't quite make it work. And they miss a lot of, they try to restructure the conflict in a way which doesn't quite work, and restructure some of the story beats that they don't quite work.
Hmm. Mm-hmm. Apples.
Yeah, I saw the movie. At the time, it was kind of entertaining, but or the game. I never played Part 3, but Remedy, Max Payne 1 and 2, Alan Wake, and I think Quantum Break was a really good idea. I love Alan Wake, though. Alan Wake has to be my favorite Remedy game so far.
Same here.
I never play those games.
Alan Wake gets some crap due to how the shooting works in the game, somewhat justifiably, but it builds a sense of mood and atmosphere in an amazing way. And because I'm from the Pacific Northwest, and the game is set out there, and I've been the area that the game is set in is designed in a way that it could not actually exist in the Coast Range or the Cascades or wherever the heck they put it. But the idea of what the place looks like, and the trees and the wildlife and the logging town and all this sort of stuff, I get that. In fact, part of the fun that made it work resonate so well with me is I played the game for the first time after going on vacation to Crater Lake, and a lot of the area around where the game is set feels like it's like not that far away from Crater Lake, like Cascade Range, logging area, old logging towns, that sort of thing. So it's sort of like, I kind of get the feeling of now when I hear about people who play like who live in the Chicago area and play Watch Dogs. Maybe they may not like the gameplay that much, but they go, hey, it's Chicago. I recognize these bits of Chicago. They've got the character of the area down very well.
I actually like Watchdog.
Oh.
I thought it wasn't the best game, but it was okay. I'm hoping for the sequel, though.
I think there's already a sequel confirmed, from what I understand.
Yeah, sequel's okay. Confirmed.
They said it's got to work on the driving aspects. That's the biggest issue, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's one of the games that I was really looking forward to, but just never got around to playing.
I remember I had to wait, an extra month for me to play it, because I ended up switching my game to the PS4.
Mm-hmm. I could see them making a Watch Dogs movie, too, surprisingly. It'd be a little bit different, but I could see them trying to do one of those. Especially if Assassin's Creed does well, you know they're gonna make a Ghost Recon movie, a Splinter Cell movie. You're gonna see movies every year from Ubisoft if this does well, because I mean they're gonna do what works.
Yeah,
people keep buying the games, they'll keep making them. People keep buying the movies, they'll keep making them.
I was actually gonna make say something silly about you think they're gonna make Assassin's Creed movie every year, and it gets shittier and shittier as they go.
If they can't get a Transformers movie out every year, we're probably not going to get an Assassin's Creed movie every year.
It'll be some sort of rotation that they do.
Yeah. We're going to alternate Transformers movies and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movies now. It's going to be alternating Assassin's Creed and Ghost Recon movies.
Yep. Michael Bay does both of those, doesn't he?
Yes.
He produces Turtles, but he does not direct.
Okay, I see.
I think he secretly does, though.
Probably.
Like Poltergeist.
I never seen Poltergeist.
So, speaking of movies that I'm not going to see anytime soon...
from the 80s. Even tying into 80s film franchises.
Yeah, exactly. Rebooting. If you guys don't know... Yes, we do need a Voltron movie, by the way. Yeah. A-Squared. But to get onto the other trailer, which is the Ghostbusters trailer, I just want to do my quick rant, and then you guys can say whatever you want, but I just got to get this out of my system. The new Ghostbusters trailer, the second trailer for Ghostbusters dropped. I'm not impressed. It's a good trailer, I think, but this is my problem with this one and the second one, or the first one, is that the one thing... which is the most obvious, is they keep playing the whole black girl race car thing, and it, like, I feel like the I don't know her name, I don't know the actress's name, I know she's on the SNL, but she is like the, what is the word? I can't think of the word right now. She's a comic relief, I feel, but more than that, she's just a token black girl. Not the token black person, because I don't even want gender to be a part of this, because it has nothing to do with gender whatsoever. So that whole thing, like every time she's on screen by herself, she's just doing something. And she even pulls the black card in the trailer, and I'm just like, are we not past this yet? Like, can we? I mean, it's I like racism. It's funny, but it's just, I don't know. This is not that impressive to me. The other thing with this is that there's not really too much substance, but they're pulling from the fandom of Ghostbusters, but they're also pulling from the fandom of what is his name? Chris Hemsworth. Chris Hemsworth is going to be the villain in this movie, and I think, Tyler, you said this, they should have just put this trailer out first. And I agree. Yes. They should have just went ahead and put this trailer out there, because they probably would have gotten more positive reviews from it. But I just think this is kind of a way to just get somebody handsome who it was Thor, and just have him be a big source of people wanting to go see this movie. I think they're pulling on the girl power, which is really cool. I have nothing against girl power, but the movie as itself, if there wasn't the original Ghostbusters, I wonder how well this movie would stand on its own two feet. Because they're pulling on the Ghostbusters fans, they're pulling on the Thor fandom, and to me, it's just... I feel like it's not really much the...
I got a question. Why is it pulling on the Thor fandom?
Chris Hemsworth. He's a villain.
Yeah, so, yeah, but it's not like Thor is going to be in there saying he's a ghost.
No, right, but look.
The fandom that came out of Thor for Chris Hemsworth, I will kind of disagree on the Chris Hemsworth thing as far as that much being a factor, because when I look at Chris Hemsworth's filmography, after Thor, the main films that he's done that have been particularly successful, as far as that have featured him as a major role, have been after the original Thor, are other Thor movies. Because, like, he was in Expendables 2 as a bit character who's killed off in the end of, in the first reel. And I think Chris Hemsworth, I don't swing that way, but I have it on good authority that he's an attractive man.
I like the way you worded that.
But on the other side of the coin, I mean, there are also plenty of other male actors. If they're looking for a pretty muscular male face, they could have gone as well. They could have gotten what's his face from Magic Mike.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I'm Channing Tatum.
Channing Tatum. They could have gotten Channing Tatum for that. If they're looking for that same sort of, we want a hunky male guy who women will come to the theaters to see because in the movie like this to be male sex appeal, they could have just as easily gotten Channing Tatum because, hell, the whole idea behind Magic Mike 2 was male sex appeal. But it's, as far as my thoughts on the movie itself go, none of the jokes have really hit it off with me. I don't see many comedies in theaters in general, but none of the jokes really struck a chord. I'm not really planning to see the movie in theaters, but I don't see a lot of movies in theaters anyway. But it's not like, it's not catching my interest. It's the kind of thing where, this isn't like we're dead with like the Deadpool trailers, the Star Wars trailers, where I'm watching it and I'm like, yes, this is really gonna be my thing. I'm gonna go see this opening weekend. It's gonna be awesome. This is like, if I see this in theaters, it's gonna be because I see good reviews in the newspapers or magazines or on the internet. It's not gonna be because I'm going to see this on the strength of it, on the merits of the Ghostbusters franchise. And nothing against any of the actresses in this movie. It's just the jokes aren't hitting it, and I don't know if it's the writing or what. Or if it's just these are badly put together trailers. I mean, I've heard that with the original 1980s Ghostbusters movie, like, it had really bad trailers. Even for the time, really bad trailers. And I don't know, but this is kind of bad in a different way. As far as the race thing goes, I do agree it's handled kind of crappy in this trailer, and kind of what caught my attention this more is, like, I watched the second trailer, and kind of went, eh. Then I watched a second YouTube video, which had before it as a pre-roll ad, the new CBS television series Timeless, or NBC television series Timeless, which involves time travel, and one of the main characters in that, the pilot of the time machine, is a black guy, and they bring up the race stuff in there, and it's handled so much better. Like, there's a line in there where when the guy is recruited to fly the time machine, the black guy, and his first response is, "You do realize there is no time period in history that works out well for me."
No!
And it's like, yeah. Like, oh, hey, that's how you do it.
Yeah. Like, I mean, there's no problem with addressing the fact that racism exists, because it does. But when you're typecasted as the angry black girl, like, that's what you could just replace with any other angry black girl rapper, actor, and you wouldn't even notice a difference. I mean, I know she plays on SNL and she's a funny actress, and I don't want to take anything away from her. I mean, hell, I would act as the angry black girl if I was getting that kind of money. But it's just kind of a Hollywood thing. Is kind of sad, you know, that. She's one of the four main characters, but every time she has some sort of screenplay, she's just doing the whole stereotypical ghetto black girl sort of thing. And that gets really old to me. Really, really old. Leslie Jones, thank you, Cody. Or moviegoer. So, I don't know. I hope I'm wrong, but just seeing that trailer, I got extraordinarily angry, and I don't tend to get very angry. I don't tend to rant about things I haven't even seen yet. But yeah, for some reason, that movie, I don't plan on seeing it in theaters, I don't think. I don't know, it's just... If Ghostbusters wasn't a thing, I don't think it'd do too well. But I do like... I would like to counter myself and say, I think it was the main protagonist in the first one was Sigourney Weaver, right? Was it Sigourney Weaver?
Sigourney Weaver was the female lead, but yeah, she was the one who was possessed by Zool.
Or antagonist.
Antagonist, yeah. Yes. Yeah. She was basically, when the antagonist became personified, it was Sigourney Weaver in there. And I'll say that Sigourney Weaver is a very different... as far as looking at her filmography, she has a much more mixed degree of casting work, whereas like Chris Hemsworth... I don't think he's established himself quite as much as an actor at this point. I mean, he's still done Thor movies, and he's done some good stuff, but it's like Sigourney Weaver at this point, she's done Aliens. Let me look up her IMDb.
Oh, she's done Aliens. She's done Avatar.
Yeah, but like at the time Ghostbusters came out, she'd done Alien, she'd done... okay, she hadn't done that much, but she'd done Alien, she did The Year of Living Dangerously, so she'd done some significant dramatic work, and she'd also done some TV stuff, including, some comedy stuff there. And so, whereas, if I go for,
Chris
Hemsworth.
Mm-hmm.
And look at his filmography. We've got we have a couple TV series things. We have Thor.
And the Huntsman.
Yeah, the Huntsman. We have as far as for alternate stuff, which probably is a little better performances from him and showing a bit more of his depth. Is you have Cabin in the Woods.
I love that movie. That was great.
That movie's amazing.
And we have Rush, which was the Formula One racing movie.
Hmm.
With Sylvester Stallone.
He was in it, right?
Wasn't he?
No. That's something else. You're thinking of something else. You're thinking of I know what you're talking about.
Or that. Ooh,
no, this is the one with Hemsworth and Daniel Brühl is the other actor. It's a docudrama directed by Ron Howard. Hemsworth plays James Hunt. Brühl plays Niki Lauda. There's probably someone in the chat who actually knows Formula One who's probably like posting over and over again, like, "Oh yes, that movie. It's awesome. You should have watched it." Actually, I haven't watched it yet. But other than that, it's like a lot of kind of mediocre. Like, look. Aside from the Thor stuff, it's mostly kind of mediocre movies. Well, Thor in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, it's like, okay, Snow White and the Huntsman, and then the Huntsman Winter's War. The new installment of the National Lampoon's Vacation story, the series, which I've heard was absolutely terrible.
Oh, it's atrociously bad. And he was also in Black Hat, which is...
Yeah, Black Hat. Like, I wanted to like that movie because I like Michael Mann, but apparently that movie was utter rubbish. Don't worry
about
it. That wasn't a Michael Mann movie so much as it was a studio wanting to bank on Chris Hemsworth.
Yeah, that's true, but like, hey, it's what? I mean, I like Michael Mann stuff. I own Heat, I own Collateral.
What?
Michael Mann was... Did he do Man on Fire?
No, Man on Fire was Tony Scott.
Most times, guy, yeah.
Hmm.
Whoa. Hey, whoa, hang on.
Got a whole bunch of people here.
That's right. It's exploding. That's what's happening now.
What is going on here?
The one Chris Hemsworth movie that needs to be talked about for his great acting ability, because Ian's not here, but he will watch this. The remake of Red Dawn.
Yes.
Oh,
there's a movie that didn't need to be remade. Speaking of movies that aren't necessary remakes,
what's Red Dawn about? Please tell me.
So the
remake of Red Dawn is an invasion of the United States by North Korea.
And not the original.
The original was the invasion of the United States by an alliance of Cuba and the Soviet Union, which makes a little more sense.
Yeah, it's nuts.
I mean, because the Soviet Union, we kind of had for a period of, 40 years, a certain degree of diplomatic and military tension between the two of us, perhaps bringing us to the brink of global thermonuclear war.
I mean, that and Rocky IV are the best Cold War movies.
Yeah, Rocky IV!
Just say that now.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm pretty sure I've seen all the Rocky movies. Now, what's Rocky IV about?
I got this one. It's the one where Rocky stops the Cold War.
Yeah.
On Christmas.
On Christmas?
The Russian guy?
There you go.
Yes, I love that one.
Yeah. He knows that movie.
Yes, I love that one. Let's go watch it.
Rocky movie.
Let's go watch it.
Yes. Movie time. We'll watch that later. We'll have
later.
But yeah, good point, Jared. Good point. So did you guys have anything to add on to anything we talked about previously?
I just wanted to add, you were talking about Ghostbusters 3, and you talked about how the African-American character seemed just like this token character.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you're right. Whereas you watch the original one, and Ernie Hudson isn't this token character. A guy that needs a job, he's pivotal to the Ghostbusters, and he's not, look, there's a Cadillac over here. You want to drink some Colt 45? It's like, whoa.
I would.
Yes, because Billy Dee Williams tells me to, first of all.
That was great.
But you seem wholly unnecessary in a movie set in the year 2016 now. Like, your character is now... You're an obsolete character, and I don't understand why they wrote you this way, and not more like Ernie Hudson.
Right, and this was, 20 or 30 years ago?
84.
84, right. 30-some years ago now.
32 years ago.
Yeah, so it
he's
just...
I'm not old.
Ernie Hudson's great, though. Great actor. Great voice awesome. Actor. He does, not Arbiter, but... Yeah, Arbiter.
Yeah, he's Arbiter.
And Anderson... in Mass Effect. Mm-hmm.
Arbiter and Anderson is someone else.
Keith David. I get him confused all the time. I'm not racist, I swear. I just get him confused.
No, but Keith David has an amazing voice. And he's also an amazing actor. Those are two actually extremely underrated actors in general.
They are. Yeah.
Ernie Hudson was the man and didn't get enough great roles.
That's right.
Yep.
I agree.
But yeah, that was my little rant about that. I'm not even a huge Ghostbusters fan. I liked the first two, and the game was actually pretty good, too, if you've never played the game.
Yes, I actually heard great things about that. They said that is the true Ghostbusters 3.
Yeah, the game's really fun.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the original voice cast, which was amazing, and got all that same humor. You're just playing it instead of watching it.
Why can't they just, take the games, just make it into a movie? You have all the voiceovers done, just do it.
Yeah. Well, because originally what was supposed to happen was the game was supposed to be a predecessor of, almost like a prequel to the part 3 of, hey, if you play the game, you know why they now franchised off the Ghostbusters to different cities, because at the end of the game, that's what happens, right? Mm. So technically it's part of the lore and was part of the, this is what it was going to be type idea. Which and another game company that did the same thing was the Bourne Conspiracy.
Yeah.
In the Jason Bourne series, that game falls in between the movies and is part of the lore. So if you watch the movies, you're missing one because you have to play the game.
I don't know. I never heard of the movie or the game.
Yeah. None of that. So, but yeah, Jared's right. Initially, and that was Dan Aykroyd's original script for Ghostbusters 3 set. Today was there are older basically training new Ghostbusters. Like there's going to be a Ghostbusters Academy and stuff like that, and they're going to have a cavalcade of great comedians like Seth Rogen, James Franco, They wanted to have, I think at one point Ron Funches was talked about being in it. If anybody knows who that is, he's really funny.
I'd love to see Aziz Ansari, too.
Aziz, I think, was talked about. Like, that whole group was talked about, you know, becoming the new Ghostbusters through the Ghostbusters Academy, and it was going to be like Police Academy meets Ghostbusters.
That would have been amazing, Hollywood. Why? Why? Why can't that be a thing?
Yeah. And the franchise idea actually kind of existed even before the video game as well, because as someone who comes from tabletop role-playing game background, fandom, West End Games put out the back in the early 90s, like late 80s, early 90s, the Ghostbusters tabletop role-playing game. And that was the premise of the game, was your player characters were franchisees of the Ghostbusters brand, and you were out busting ghosts and that sort of thing, and they had guidelines for, okay, how do you set up your franchise? They were a whole bunch of adventures for based on ideas of what you could do for your or ghosts that you could take. One of the ones that I remember sticks out in my mind was a haunted movie studio in Japan that was shooting a kaiju movie, and you'd be busting a ghost on this kaiju movie set and smashing miniature Tokyo.
See, why don't they make a real game like that, like a simulation, like Tycoon, Ghostbusters franchise Tycoon? I'd buy it.
Yeah, I would too. But yeah, that see, so that idea has been around forever. Like, and because it's always what Dan Aykroyd wanted to do ultimately. Like, because after Ghostbusters 2, he wanted to take a long break from Ghostbusters, and Harold Ramis and everybody else did, so they did. And then come back 10 years later and do a Ghostbusters Academy. I don't even think it was called Ghostbusters 3. I literally think it was called Ghostbusters Academy.
I know one thing that put a big stop in that whole situation was Harold Ramis was helping having a script written that they were going to greenlight, because it was being written by the comedic people behind Year One, and then that movie flopped. So,
yeah.
Meh.
That kind of said, okay, that's done.
And then now, of course, Harold Ramis, rest in peace, has passed away, and then we got this thing. Thank you, green lid.
Yeah.
Oh. See, unfortunately, I'll probably be the enemy in this, but the second trailer makes me want to see the movie more than the first one.
I don't blame him. If you compared it from the second trailer to the first trailer made me want to stay away from the movie. But if they released the second trailer first, it kind of did make me want to see it.
Yeah, I kind of get your human trailer number two at least gave me a hint of what the story of this is going to be. It still looks like it's the same story as the first one. Like you're back at they're back at the hotel, for the climax or whatever. But
yeah. Climax.
I mean, I'm still not saying the movie's going to be great, and I'm still not saying I'm going to go see it opening weekend, but. To play devil's advocate, trailer number two is certainly, it is a better trailer in terms of giving an idea of what this movie is going to be and theoretically putting some hooks to draw people into the movie, aside from trailer number one. Trailer number one is, oh, it's a Ghostbusters movie, here are the Ghostbusters, you want to see this because it's Ghostbusters. Trailer number two is, it's a Ghostbusters movie, they're out busting ghosts, and there's this big supernatural threat threatening New York that these people have to get together and stop. I do kind of like... there was one kind of bit in the trailer which did kind of catch my interest, which was the heavy metal concert that they're busting ghosts at in the trailer, which it looks like they actually got Slayer for the trailer, for that really? Scene. Because I don't get a good look at the name of the band or their backdrop, but it looks like they got like it's they're busting ghosts at a Slayer concert, which okay. Again, it's not I want to go see this in theaters, but we're getting closer to the when it ends up on Netflix or Amazon Prime, Amazon or whatever, I will rent it then.
See, the biggest thing between the first trailer and the second trailer was the fact that the first trailer was 30 years. It was playing off the nostalgia of the Ghostbusters. And it left you wondering, is this a remake? Is this a reboot? Is this a continuation? It left too many questions. And that's what really I didn't like about the first one. The second one actually shows you, no, this is what it is. This is how good it is. And this movie is going to be fantastic. So buckle up and get ready for a ride of your life.
So here's the thing. The people surrounding this movie are all very funny, individually. I'm a big fan of Kristen Wiig. I'm a big fan of Melissa McCarthy. But from both trailers, they don't seem to have the same chemistry the original Ghostbusters did. It's not there. Like, I just don't see it. I don't see that Aykroyd and Murray and Ramis and Hudson chemistry that was there originally. That's what made the movie so great. It was fun because you could show it to a kid because they're busting ghosts, and it's like, this is funny. But what made it so great, and something you can watch from 6 years old to however old you think you're going to live, me, 9,000, and always laugh at it with simple lines like, we would be fine if this dickless son of a bitch didn't shut down the power generator. And he goes, and they go through the whole thing. He's like, is this true? And Bill Murray responds with, yes, it's true. This man really has no dick. That line is gold.
Or even, hey, let's split up. We can do more damage that way.
Yeah.
But it
doesn't seem there. Like, in the first trailer when, I can't think of the actress's name, she's from Saturday Night Live, but the African-American woman is slapping Melissa McCarthy and is like, get out of her, devil woman. It's like, have we moved past this?
That's what really turned me off from that trailer.
And yeah, that's what I'm saying.
I feel like the chemistry was there.
I think this cast worked together previously, because I know with the original Ghostbusters cast, large chunks of them were Saturday Night Live alums, and the ones who weren't were SCTV alums. And so they'd all done comedy work together before. And so they knew going in, because they were the brains behind this, that they had the chemistry and what jokes would work together and that they could play off of each other, because there was a lot of improv in that movie to a degree that would make the movie work. And I'm kind of wondering, with the remake, how much of these women worked together in terms of films before? Have they worked together enough to build the chemistry? And for that matter, how heavily scripted is this? Like, a great example of this is, a while back, did on a podcast for another site, Bureau42.com, talking about Ghostbusters. And there's a thing I learned from when I was doing the podcast on it, was, so there's the scene in the movie where they introduce where we learn that you're not supposed to cross the streams because you could have total protonic reversal. That bit was improv'd. Harold Ramis, because they hadn't finished writing the script at that time when they shot that scene, knew he had to figure out a conclusion for the movie, and decided to spot, don't cross the streams. So, like, hey, don't cross the streams. Why shouldn't we do that? Because it would be we'd have total protonic reversal, and that's why there's those pauses in there, and you get like, and then everyone feeds off of that, and Dan Aykroyd improvs the line about every atom in your body going in different directions at the speed of light and that sort of thing. And that was entirely improv, and that wasn't scripted, and I don't think this movie has a degree of improvisation and trusting your other actors and playing off each other that the original film necessarily has, based on what I see in these trailers.
Yeah, and on that note, I do say, I think I will see it just to kind of see how my strong reactions are towards this movie. Normally, I don't tend to get this upset about a trailer. I don't know what it was, but I do think that we should have a podcast later on about it for whoever did see it. I know Jared's probably going to see it. But yeah, I'd like to see the before and the after and talk about this movie. Hopefully, I hope my opinions change. I doubt that very much so from the trailer that I saw. But I'll try to be as unbiased as I can going into the movie. I tend to go into movies with very low expectations, and that's why when I do seldom go to movie, they're usually exceeded. But for anyone who does plans to go to the the movie.
Oh yeah, don't you know?
I was like a Guido, Michigan guy. I don't know what the hell that was. But,
yeah, you make the mom from Bobby's World with like.
Fire in the mud, Bobby.
But yeah, I'd like to know what everyone thinks that saw it after it. But yeah, that turned into a longer conversation than I thought it was going to turn into. I thought it was going to be a short rant, but yeah, I'm glad that some people hopped in and shared their thoughts on that because everyone seems to have some sort of opinion, a strong opinion on it.
Oh, we're just getting started.
Uh-oh. You got more to add there?
Oh, no, not to this. I'm just waiting for the next topic.
Okay, so the next topic, speaking of angry nerds, is the Santa Fe Comic Con.
Oh, here we go.
I don't know if I should let Jared introduce this, if he knows enough about this. Did you want to take it, Jared, or do you want me to go ahead and...
I can do it.
Cool.
Okay, so in the world of conventions and in the world of expos, you always have people trying to get noticed, trying to get to these conventions in any way possible, and they do get expensive. And some conventions do pay people to come. They'll buy your hotel, they'll buy your food, they'll buy your plane ticket to have you come there. So, you know, they do that. So you have a lot of amateur, quote unquote, not saying that they're not professional in any point, but you have amateur people, cosplayers, gaming people, YouTube personalities who want to be part of this, who think they're good enough or bring enough of an audience for these conventions and want the same expenses paid, I guess. So there's one cosplayer, I think they had 20,000 or 50,000 likes on Facebook. 20,000 likes on Facebook wanted the Santa Fe Comic Con to pay their way and expenses and food to their event if they would come there and panel or whatever. And the convention said no. They could have just said no, thank you. We want to focus on local artists and local cosplayers, but thank you for your inquiry. Have a nice day. But instead, opened up a large can of worms, in the sense of
ass whooping.
Belittled the person, belittled cosplayers, belittled the whole fact of this person's a fake cosplayer, and brought in just a shitstorm of anyone that's ever been in HR or PR or any type of marketing. This is a classic no-no. You want to know how to do something wrong? Do what this guy did, all right? It was a Facebook battle between himself and lots of other cosplayers and regular people who just stumbled upon it. And, yeah, so it's a shitstorm now. Some people agree with the cause with the convention. You know, they don't want fake people coming. They don't want model, quote-unquote, who just dress up in superheroes to sell boobs. And some people say, well, amateur cosplayers are just as good as regular cosplayers and should be respected, but really, it comes down to the, in my opinion, the way it was handled. It was improper. So, what do you think?
Yeah.
Class. So, sorry.
Go ahead.
Class, this is why community managers exist. And if you are running a convention, you're particularly one if you're franchising the Comic-Con name, which I don't know if Santa Fe Comic-Con was doing, but if you are franchising the Comic-Con name, if you're attached to that organization or trying to appear to be attached to that organization, you hire a community manager. So if you're to let people down easy, if you are choosing not to, for example, highlight a cosplayer or comp their hotel stay or their airfare or their food or their con membership.
This just sounds like a PR nightmare that could have easily been avoided with a simple no thank you. You're not wrong. That's all it is. You're not wrong. It's not, yes, he shouldn't have belittled somebody by being like, you're a fake cosplayer and just want to show your boobies. But you also shouldn't be like, get me to this convention and pay for it. I'm begging you.
Right.
When you get to that point, you'll get there. But if you're not at that point and you're not asked, don't beg.
I agree.
It could have turned around the exact 180% because it'd say, okay, fine, this person's not going to let me come. So now I'm going to belittle this convention as much as I possibly can. I mean, you got to look at 180 turntables. That's me, though.
I kind of say the response to that as someone who, to a certain degree, kind of pays attention to like convention running stuff. In fact, I've been on a couple mailing lists or Facebook lists and stuff that other people who run conventions are on. And one of the things that come up that I've picked up from stuff of this is like, if you're getting invited to a convention and getting your room and hotel stay and attendance fees covered, that is because you are an invited guest of honor who they are putting in the book. And that is basically, I'm not going to say industry standard, but as much as there's an industry behind fan conventions, to a certain degree there is, that is kind of the standard thing, is if you are big enough to be a draw in your own right and you are thus invited by the convention because they want that draw, they will do that. They will cover that. If they're not interested in inviting you, whether because they have someone else they have in mind, or because they don't think you're a big enough draw yet, or any other number of myriad factors, then going out and saying and soliciting for, soliciting is the wrong word, but okay, no, it is kind of the right word, soliciting for, hey, book me as a guest, pick me for your cosplay guest of honor, that doesn't necessarily work. And if you're bitching and moaning because you didn't get picked as cosplay guest of honor, even if it just makes you look bad, and the best thing for the convention to do is to just let them complain and moan off on their own because your attendees and your guests, the ones that you've picked as your guests of honor, will speak in your defense, will be a much better advocate for you than you punching back.
I agree to that because I did read the article that Cass showed here, and the guy said, or the the director, whatever, he just said, hey, you know what, you can come here, but you got to sell $200 worth of our tickets. Right there, I think that killed it, to be honest. That's just me, though.
Yeah.
It looks like what you have here is a case of two people with very bad social skills trying to go back and forth on Facebook. I think the first part was the girl being wrong for... It's one thing to ask. That's fine. It doesn't hurt to ask, for sure. But then when someone says no, you don't continue on. But then I think what really, really fucked it up was when they said, oh, geez, what am I, your family? And that kind of... That started the whole entire thing because... Yeah, if I had an event and I was only supporting local people, no, I'm sorry, you can't come. You're welcome to come, but I'm not going to pay your expenses just because you have a certain number of followers. You don't get a cut in line. You know, I have a certain niche that I'm focusing on, and you're not that. I'm sorry if you're offended. I'm sorry if you can't make it, but that you're not my target audience right now. I want to get these people here and support them. Me bringing you here doesn't help me any. And you're not offering me anything. You're only begging for something. So, Go ahead.
And I think that was the biggest thing was, you know, he said, if you can sell $200, I'll give you a table, if you can sell $200 worth of tickets. And she replied by, well, how am I supposed to do that?
Yeah. I mean, honestly, I'd say probably the best response, you know, even that response is a little kind of flippant and unprofessional. Is from what I've picked up from other people involved in con running, is the appropriate response for a case like this is like either find a happy medium, which is like, for example, if you're looking for panelists and that sort of thing, say, hey, I'm not going to cover your airfare, I'm not going to cover your meals, I'm not going to cover your hotel stay, but if you're interested in running a panel, we have open panel spots, pitch an idea, and if we like it, we will reimburse you your convention membership, which is what a lot of conventions do to encourage people to do panels.
You're hired.
Yeah, yeah. We'll reimburse you your membership for if you do a panel. It gives us programming to fill our panel blocks. Particularly if you have this many people, sure, who follow you on Facebook, sure, that means people will come to your panel. But it's not necessarily going to sell memberships just on the basis of you, as opposed to say, getting an anime voice actor, getting somebody who's on Heroes of Cosplay or whatever, getting a comic artist or writer, that sort of thing. When you get to, as Tavian said, with the flippant, well, what am I, your family stuff and the Or even to a certain degree the well, if you sell 20,000 tickets, then I might give you a I'll give you a table. That's a little different. I mean, it's and a certain degree also, even then you're kind of snubbing the people in the dealer's room, or an artist's alley who had to pay money for their tables and that sort of thing. Even the ones who are necessarily major artists, like, for example, my local anime convention, KimuraCon. Dark Horse Comics has a panel there every year. I still would not be surprised if Dark Horse Comics, to a certain degree, has to pay for their table space.
Well, like,
I mean, their table space in dealer's room is probably a rounding error on their on their monthly expenses, much less their annual expenses. But it's still, they probably still have to pay for their to get a table in the dealer's room.
I would believe it. I mean, here's my thing, and this is why I side more with, even though I don't agree with his approach, I side more with the event guy, because I mean he's the one throwing it in the first place. I don't agree with the way he went about it, but and I have to think about the interview that I recently had. It's not posted anywhere just yet, but I interviewed the event organizer for Combo Breaker, which is an event in a couple of weeks for a fighting game tournament. And this guy has people like Ed Boon, the creator of Mortal Kombat, Seth Killian, someone who's a very popular personality but also worked on Street Fighter. He has a lot of other personalities come in that are very popular, but he focuses on the little guy, on helping and talking to and helping to cultivate the nobody, the people who go there and love what he does. He's not trying to support the people who already have a following. He's trying to help create a following and help this community. And I think that's kind of where this guy might have been trying to go, but he didn't have the social skills to say it properly. And so, yeah, it's a weird situation, and I don't know exactly. It's kind of interesting to see that these people are so up in arms about it. I don't know what all information is out there. I kind of want to do some more research on it, but it does seem that a lot of people are kind of jumping the gun. Jared, do you know which side that people are primarily on? They're actually against this guy, or they're for it?
You have a lot of major cosplayers pulling out of Santa Fe. Saying straight up, they will not deal with the unprofessionalism of the way that it was handled. Yes, they understand the situation, but there's a proper way of handling it. Making it public on Facebook, making it public on Twitter, because he made it public. It was a strict PM personal message talk between the two people. He made it public just to stop it.
And I can understand that. I can understand, Kaz, because if you got a chance to get exposed or something like that. Do you want the guy on Second Street that just supposing, hey, you know, I'll work for food, or do you want like William Shatner? I mean, come on, that's how I see it. You know, if you want exposure, you're going to get exposure, and when the unprofessional like this has happened, that's just not acceptable. You know, to me, it's not. I've read the whole article and I saw it and I was like, I read everything and I kind of digest as best I can. I know I shaved this beard and I know it's gone a little bit, but I still got a little up here yet. And it's just, you know, that's how I've been reading into it. And it's like, you know, he should have just did a simple fucking response. That's my point.
So, yeah, you know. I agree with that.
Hmm.
Yeah, so I think the mistake was him making it public. He should have just kept it to himself.
And that's the biggest thing, right? Like, it's a nightmare in that sense. And like I said, you had people who've dealt with Santa Fe say, oh, they were good, they were great, but because of this, I'm not dealing with them anymore. So you really shot yourself in the foot on this, and it's a shame. But I understand from a cosplayer's point of view, trying to get out there, because all it takes is one event to say yes, right? Because, I mean, if we all went out there to promote the console explosion, and we all sent emails out to conventions, and all it took was one to say yes, we'll pay for your hotel, we'll pay for your flights, we'll pay for you guys to come out, that's all it takes, right? One convention to say yes, and boom, that's it. And I see it from their point of view, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, moral of the story is keep your shit to yourself, people. Stop sharing your public videos. That's because the internet is a thing. Does not mean you gotta post every damn story online. Keep it to yourself.
And also, if you run any sort of large organization, particularly dealing with like with tens of thousands of people, having on-staff community managers, so like there are communications majors out there who would like jobs. It shouldn't be too hard to find one to hire and to communicate for you, because God knows you need someone who can.
But on the other hand, there was something that the convention artist or the convention guy did bring up that I think is another topic we can quickly just tackle here. The fake cosplayers, the models who are hired to promote beer, guns, whatever, you know, professional boob models who dress up as superheroes. Mm. They're the ones who are getting these free things. They're the ones who are exploiting conventions for these things. And that's what he's trying to, you know, stop, quote unquote, is these fake cosplayers. And I can kind of see where it's at. We just finished going to the Ottawa Comic Con, and you can see ones who are professionally paid to be there as promotion models. But it also asks the question, because he's saying they're wearing skimpy clothes, they don't really follow the aspect of what a cosplayer character is, and a lot of them are turning into sexbo cosplay. You know, there's an article just in the chat there about it, gives you an idea of what I'm talking about. But, sorry. No, that's not it. Wait, is it? Yeah, whatever.
I did post the chat. I did post it in the chat, and I will post it in the show notes as well for you guys.
Yes, but for the Sexpo stuff, that's what I just posted now. Give you an idea about that article there. In regards to, you know, is this right? You know, do we draw a line at, you know, where do we draw the line up between models, quote-unquote, and real cosplayers? Or is there one?
Is there one? Right, is there one?
I say let's put up the test. If you'll come to our convention, cosplay as your favorite character, we will do research on that character, and we will give you a question so you have to answer it correctly.
Even that's
you got a lie detector?
Yeah. Not lie detector, but saying... you can call for this character. Let's question you and make sure you're legit.
Even that's a little iffy.
Yeah, it's hard.
Oh, you going to cosplay as the Joker from Batman? Okay.
Well, I mean, like, again, even then, that's iffy. Because, like, we're dealing with, like, we're not going to get to, like, characters where, like, have a bajillion years of history. Like, for example, the Joker. Mm-hmm. It starts getting into tricky and getting definition of what's a real fan, which I'm not a fan of deciding who is or is not a real fan.
I'm with you on that one.
Yeah, same here.
And so I
like boobs.
I think to be a preferred idea is actually like, I mean, a lot of cosplay conventions have specific rules for what you can and cannot, for what is or is not covered in your cosplay. And if you're trying to reduce the amount of cosplay as sex appeal for booths or whatever, as for paid models, then do cosplay restrictions that reflect that. Yeah, this may mean that perhaps people aren't dressing up as characters from Kill la Kill or what have you, but this means that you are putting on the other hand, putting on a show which has which feels more family friendly and appeals more audiences, and that way if people are doing paid cosplayers or that sort of thing, they're still wearing outfits that are that don't make the dealer's room skeezy, and also by contrast will probably also make your other female attendees feel more comfortable as well.
Yeah, and see, the thing with that is that we're talking about two entirely different things here. We're talking about real cosplayers and real fans. A real cosplayer, I'll give you the definition, is the practice of dressing up as a character from a movie, book, video game, etc., especially one from the Japanese genres of manga or anime. That's pretty much anyone who puts on an outfit. That's a cosplayer. So that's one thing. A fan is something entirely different, but that's just like with sports. Which I don't watch or follow a lot of sports, but you have the fan wagon, I guess is what they call it, where
fanatics.
Yeah, the people who are fans are the people who are winning. Right. Essentially the same.
Oh, bandwagon. Thing. Yeah.
Yeah, the bandwagon. Mm-hmm. And so with anime
Street Fighter 5 fans.
Culture,
Street Fighter 5 fans.
Oh, he brought it up! God!
I hate you so much, Tyler. I don't know why I said Tyler. I mean Jared. God damn it.
That's it. I haven't done anything.
Tyler, it's your fault again.
Not you.
No. Street Fighter V fans aren't jumping on the bandwagon because Street Fighter V isn't winning.
Yeah, no, it's not winning. Only the hardcore people like it right now. It doesn't have some good PR right now. But no, with nerd culture growing in popularity, you have a lot of people who are exploiting it for themselves, which does suck, but you can't really regulate that kind of thing. And it really falls back on the fans themselves and less so of the cosplayers, because you have these people, these guys that are gawking at these girls because they can't control themselves.
Right.
And that's why you keep getting these booth babes, or what they're called. You keep getting them, and it's not their fault. If I could get hired for $100 an hour to like stand somewhere and just wear a weird outfit and have people gawk at me, I would do that shit. Okay,
I'd be fucking Jabba.
Have my beard somewhere. Okay, cool. You know, it's not as glorious as the bearded gamers, but
But hey, I would do it if they'd hired me to be Jabba for $25 an hour, and I got some like Princess Leia by me, I'd fucking do it. Oh yeah.
What is the fat guy dressed up as Princess Leia?
I don't care if I get $25 an hour.
I have a picture from last year's FanTheFest where a fat guy wore a slave Princess Leia outfit.
All right, as long as I get the 25. Okay, 20 an hour. I know. Expenses get tight.
I've been around long enough to remember Man Fay, so I don't know what Jill's talking about.
Man Fay, oh my God, Fay Valentine Fay.
Yeah, a guy dressed as Faye Valentine.
Okay, that's what I thought. I have images in my head now. Thank you for that.
It ruined him.
Ruined. But yeah, it's a good question. It's kind of hard to debate that topic in such a short amount of time. But I think it's less about the actual cosplayer and more about the fandom and the community and what we do and don't allow as a community. You know, if we don't stand up for stuff, like you said it multiple times before, you don't support Street Fighter V, and there's a lot of people who are with you on that. And I think on that same note, with the cosplay community and things of that nature, it's how much are we going to allow ourselves what are we going to allow to represent us, and what aren't we going to allow to represent us? So that's my thinking on it. It's kind of obscure, but I think it's hard. It's a little ambiguous to figure this out. Yeah. What say you, gentlemen?
I think you hit the nail right on the head.
Yeah, I think you got it.
Cool. So we've got a whole bunch of people here. We'll try to go down the line. I had a lot of fun tonight. I didn't expect this to be so much fun. I'm glad for everyone who stopped by. I know a lot of people hopped in halfway through, but I'm glad you did. Thank you. And we'll just start from on my screen from left to right. So we'll start with Andrew. Let him know what you do and or where they can find you.
I make videos, mostly. You can find me on A-Squared Game Reviews on YouTube, but that's kind of a misnomer now because my most popular show is a show about movies that never made it off Laserdisc.
Oh, yes. Yes, good
one. Left on Laserdisc. Yeah. And next is Alex.
All right. So I am Count Zero. I do two series. I have Breaking It All Down, which is a general purpose review series, where I review various movies and books and that sort of stuff, and another series of Nintendo Power retrospectives, where I do go through every issue of Nintendo Power and review every featured game. I also have some Let's Play stuff going on, currently serialized on my YouTube channel, which is at youtube.com/user/countzeroor. I currently have a Let's Play going of Lost Planet 3. And yeah. As far as my main videos, most recent episode that came up as this recording is a discussion of where's the fair use sort of movement is standing right now. And next week, which I believe is when this is going out, I will have the next installment of my review of the Yakuza Papers series of films. I'm going to be on, I believe, part 4 of 5. So we're getting close to the end.
All right.
Yeah, part 4 of 5. And the first part of that is actually up on the consoleexplosion.com right now. If once this video is over, you want to go watch that.
Nice. All right, Bearded Gamer.
Oh, I'm up. I'm up the bat. Here we go. All right. First off, I got this beard trim because I have to because I'm getting married this Saturday.
Oh.
Congratulations. Thank you. Thank you. With Pickles. By the way, Pickles is going to be streaming tonight for the Console Explosion Twitch TV. Oh, yeah. Going to be a lot of excitement here. Anyway, so I'm the Bearded Gamer. I got my own channel, my YouTube channel. I'm just the Bearded Gamer. I just talk about a lot of different things from, you know, I don't know, games, from trending views, from stupid stuff. I wasn't going to say shit. Okay, I said shit. But anyway, I do what I do. I'm the Bearded Gamer, and that's just how I am. You can't control me. Nobody. I can't even control myself. Well, Pickles can, but that's okay. That's why I'm getting married to me. She can control my ass. But anyway, enough about me. Let's hear about the rest of these guys.
All right. Everyone knows where Jared is, but we'll, if you have some stuff to say, we'll get to you in just a second. But Tyler is the last one up the bat.
Yes. You can watch me on YouTube, The Video Game Hunter, or you can type in Hot Anime 32. Both of those names will take you to the same channel. I'm debating. I don't know what you guys want me to do, but someone asked me several months ago when I did a live stream to do a reaction video to Corpse Party. So yeah, might do a reaction video to that, and I also have a Twitter, VGH32, and sometimes I will draw, and I have a draw on my DeviantArt page, The Video Game Hunter. Donald Trump is my next drawing.
Oh yeah, it's looking pretty good, guys. It's looking pretty good.
Yes.
All right, and Jared, do you have any closing notes or anything you want to say?
No, pretty much. You can always check out theconstablevision.com. All these wonderful folks here are contributors to the website, so you get to see all their stuff on their dedicated pages, as well as make sure you check out our YouTube. Obviously, you've found it because you're watching our podcast from it. Also, if you want to take the podcast on the road, check out Podbean, and from Podbean should bring you to a Google Play and iTunes link, I think.
Yeah.
Something like that. Anyways, also make sure that you do check out our Twitch if you love live streaming and watching random people play video games. Two of these people down here are part of our Twitch team, the Video Game Hunter and the Bearded Gamer. So, as you can see, the Bearded Gamer. They're great to watch every day. Every day we have someone on there streaming. So, you know, we give you almost 24 hours of wonderful Console Explosion content, from all these guys' wonderful videos to all the stuff we make, to our stream, to our Facebook, to our Twitter. Hey, we'll give you the content. Explode your mind.
All right. Yeah, I like it. Yeah, and again, I want to thank all the people that hopped on to the chat to join me and talk about this stuff. It was really fun. As always, I appreciate you guys. Also, thank you guys that are watching in the live stream. We do. We just switched to Thursdays, 9:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, so we'll be streaming on Thursdays. So thank you to anyone who is in the chat or was at some point in chat, and to anyone watching on YouTube. Definitely hit the like button if you like this video. Leave a comment letting us know what you guys thought about anything that we talked about in this podcast. And if you like what we talked about, hit that subscribe button, because we will be doing more videos. We have the weekly wrap-up. We have all these other contents. And, of course, as I said, theconsoleexplosion.com. And as always, I'm the philosopher. I will be having a new video up soon. I did interview Richard Thayer, the guy who the event organizer for Combo Breaker, which is happening this Memorial Day. I'm very excited about that. Very big fighting game tournament. Second time I've gone to. It's the second one they've done. So I will have that up as soon as possible if you guys are curious about Combo Breaker. But you can find me on Facebook.com/philosopher, YouTube.com/philosopher, and Twitter.com/TheFilosopher. But of course, always on the Console Explosion and on the Console Explosion podcast. So thank you guys so much, and I will see you in the next one.